Welcome, everyone, to the launch of One Century After Thind. It's a special issue of Ethnic Studies Review that was edited by me, Linta Varghese, and Soniya Munshi. The issue is currently available on the Ethnic Studies Review website, and it's currently, all the articles are free, so it's not behind a paywall. So we're delighted to host this panel discussion with Mizue Ezeki, Kiri Seilata, and Prachi Patankar. But before we move to our panel discussion, we wanted to speak briefly about the impetus for the issue and the approach that Soniya and I took. So in putting this collection together, we took the 100th anniversary of the Supreme Court case, the United States versus Bhagat Singh Thind, as an opportunity to revisit the case itself, as well as open up broader questions regarding migration, citizenship, caste, racialization, and naturalization as sites of inquiry that illuminate the dynamics of empire, colonization, and nation building. As South Asian Americanists, we have used the case text in our classrooms and in our own research within the broader field of Asian American studies. And through these engagements, we noticed the ways that the case had become a flashpoint for multiple analyses of South Asian racialization in the United States. And more importantly, we kind of noticed this like shift in the arc of how the case is understood and what it signifies about South Asian American history, solidarities, and belonging.
As many of you know, Thind is one of the many judicial and executive acts, including the Page Law passed in 1875, the Chinese Exclusion Act of 1882, the Immigration Act of 1917, and Ozawa versus the United States, 1922. These acts that have long been understood as legal mechanisms that have placed Asians outside the U.S. nation. In this particular lineage, the case is positioned as evidence of South Asian American exclusion. In the contemporary moment, however, we have seen how the case has also been positioned as evidence of South Asian American progress and eventual triumph over the structural hurdles that these communities have faced in the U.S. And then at other times, also, it is seen as indicative of complicity with whiteness and caste oppression, in part due to Thind's legal claim that as a, quote, high caste Hindu of full Indian blood born at Amritsar, Punjab, India, end quote, he was a, quote, white person within the meaning of Section 2169 Revised Statutes, end quote, of the 1870 Naturalization Act, a claim that leveraged racist ideologies rooted in anti-Black and settler colonial logics, as well as casteist ideologies rooted in Brahminical supremacy. As Asian American studies scholars, we are interested in the ways that the Thind case continues to circulate, how these interpretations, how the interpretations of the case both persist and are reconstituted through political and social dynamics in South Asian American communities that have largely been formed in the almost 60 years since the 1965 Hart-Celler Act was passed. Holding this multiplicity of meanings, we approached this special issue one century after Thind as an opportunity to illustrate the varying legacies of the case, the heterogeneities of South Asian American communities, and our uneven locations with respect to legal and social citizenship, past and present. The special issue includes pieces that are grounded in different forms of scholarly inquiry, disciplinary approaches, methodologies, and intellectual and creative frameworks. We offer this collection as a contribution to generate thinking and learning about the case, its themes, and ongoing questions that it provokes.
So just kind of in that spirit of revisiting the case, building off of the case, and a lot of the meanings that swirl around it, we wanted to use the launch to actually continue the conversation and extend discussions contained in the issue. So to this end, we invited our three speakers today to deepen and expand our engagement with Thind by picking up on themes and topics in the issue, specifically the racialized citizenship debates in the early 20th century that were part of U.S. state making, historical and contemporary criminalization of migration, migrants, and borders, and caste in the South Asian diaspora. Our first speaker will be Kiri Seilata, an assistant professor in American Studies at McAllister College. She earned her PhD and MA in American Studies from the University of Michigan, Ann Arbor, and her BA in American Studies from McAllister College. She was a UC President's postdoctoral fellow in Asian American Studies at UCLA. And she's working on a book project entitled The Making of Samoa Amelika, which examines the formation of American Samoa as a territory and attending U.S. citizenship debates in the early 20th century. After Kiri, Mizue Ezeki will speak. Mizue is the executive director and founder of the Surveillance Resistance Lab, a think and act tank that builds networks of collaboration to make the threat of surveillance at the nexus of state and corporate power visible. For nearly 20 years, she has focused on ending the injustices at the intersection of criminal and migration control systems. Mizue was a senior advisor at the Immigrant Defense Project and the founder of the Surveillance, Tech, and Immigration Project. She is a co-editor of the forthcoming collection, Resisting Borders and Technologies of Violence from Haymarket Books, and her photographic work appears in Dying to Live, A Story of U.S. Immigration in the Age of Global Apartheid, and Policing the Planet, Why the Policing Crisis Led to Black Lives Matter. And our discussion, our panel discussion, will close with Prachi Patankar, an anti-caste and feminist writer, an activist who was born in rural Maharashtra, India. Over two decades in New York, she's been involved in social movements that link the local and the global, including police brutality and war, migration and militarization, race and caste, women of color feminism, and global gender justice. Her work has been published by Al Jazeera, The Guardian, Jadalia, Jacobin Magazine, and several other publications.
Thank you, Linta. And so just for everyone to be prepared, our format today is that each panelist will present for about 10 minutes, and then we'll have time afterwards to speak with each other and with all of you through a Q&A that will open up at the end of their presentations. Linta and I will be keeping an eye on the chat, so please feel free to drop questions in as the panelists are speaking, and then when we get to the Q&A, we'll revisit any questions or visit any questions that have been posed while they've been speaking. And so I'll turn it over now to Kiri.
Tala Falaba. My name is Kiri Satinas Iliata. I go by Kiri. I am an assistant professor in American Studies at McAllister College, and I want to start off with an acknowledgement. So first, many thanks to the folks behind the scenes organizing the talk and bringing us here today, and many thanks to Linda and Soniya for the invitation, and many congratulations to them and the amazing authors on this special issue. I also want to thank folks for being in conversation with us virtually this afternoon. Our hearts and our spirits have been heavy for almost 4 weeks now as the horror of this latest siege has continued to unfold in Gaza and in Palestine. And we're grateful for you all to be with us and be in community to hear where our work is and what we're working on, even when our minds and our hearts are elsewhere, you know. So before I offer a small snapshot of the work I do and sketch some connections to these broader conversations around the centennial of Tind and its many legacies, as well as in particular thorny questions around race, citizenship, U.S. belonging, I want to offer a land acknowledgement. So I am Zooming to you all from McAllister College, which is located in St. Paul, Minnesota, on the ancestral and contemporary homelands of the Dakota Oyate. The Dakota were and continue to be violently displaced through ongoing structures of settler colonialism. And I offer this land acknowledgement in support of their efforts towards land back as the original stewards of this place and to honor the people, their ancestors, their descendants, as well as the land and the waters that surround us. So I'm here to talk about U.S. citizenship debates in the U.S. territories, but more specifically thinking about American Samoa, which is where my work, where my family and where also my work is situated. And I also teach about Tind as well as other citizenship acts. So being located in Pacific Studies, as well as thinking about and engaged with the legal imaginary and mapping of U.S. territories, means that I often toggle between many different types of citizenship acts. So namely the insular cases in 1900, 1901, as well as some smaller and major Supreme Court cases from the late 19th century into the early 20th century. That's where the heart of my book project is, The Making of Samoa Amalika, as well as the teaching that I do. So again, being situated in Pacific studies, I'm moving often between many different registers. Again, US empire and territorialization, as well as indigenous studies. So I also am thinking about the centennial of the 1924 Snyder Act around American Indian citizenship. So this moment is actually really pivotal in us reflecting on these major debates around inclusion and racialization and the geography and imaginary of the United States in the 1920s and its legacies today. And so with that, I'm going to kind of turn to this 2015 episode from the HBO series Last Week Tonight with John Oliver, entitled U.S. Territories. And in this usual kind of satirical styling of the host, John Oliver tackles the legal quagmire of U.S. territorial law through an expose on voting rights. And this main segment, the main segment opens with an acknowledgement of the 50th anniversary of the Voting Rights Act. And then the show kind of pivots from a discussion of increasing voter restrictions across state legislatures to discussing lesser known sets of laws based on geography, the U.S. territories. So over the course of this segment, Oliver covers familiar ground within the framework of civil rights denial in, citizenship cases, but also very citizenship cases within the context of U.S. territories. He cites the Supreme Court rulings, which created the quote-unquote unincorporated territory, commonly referred to as the insular cases, and then veers to a discussion of patriotism and militarism in the territories. So how can the U.S. deny voting rights in federal elections to areas of historic and increasing military presence? And how is it possible for people with the highest enlistment rates per capita to not have U.S. citizenship or be able to vote for the commander-in-chief? And how is the two-tier geographies of the insular cases, which are, you know, were envisioned as temporary measures of separatism, still in place? And so this narrative proffered by the U.S. territories episode bears a striking parallel to the arguments made by Neil Ware, who is a civil rights attorney who has led a series of recent litigation efforts to restore the values and the principles of the U.S. Constitution through the repeal of the insular cases. And I'm going to move us here to the series of cases that Neil Ware and the Constitutional Accountability Center, Neil Ware and I should say two former organizations that he's been part of and co-founded, which is We the People and Equally American. So as Ware's organization, most recent organization, Equally American campaigns, whether one lives in a state or territory, our basic rights as citizens should be the same. And in my work, I explore these competing frameworks around the geographies of U.S. imperialism through territorial law, through the 2016 Tuolo v. United States case, birthright citizenship case, which is an exemplary study of the limitation of civil rights discourses, indigenous rights, and historical amnesia. And in the in the dissent of the infamous Downs v. Bidwell case, one of the insular cases, Fuller clarified that a main assertion of this law, the 1901 law, was that if a place were acquired by the United States, that Congress, quote, Congress has the power to keep it like a disembodied shade in an intermediate state of ambiguous existence for an indefinite period of time, end quote. So I am looking at how citizenship in the U.S. has a long history of exclusion, and as a result, you know, these range of liminal statuses that are considered partial or becoming, or as John Oliver cheekily jests in that episode, off-brand citizenship, right? And belying that civil rights framework is a teleological notion of progress, that eventually these communities will attain full citizenship, or that is indeed the aspiration. And it is an unquestioned premise for them that the quote unquote 4 million unrepresented people living in the territories desire what they don't already possess, which is full US citizenship and enfranchisement. And so what I'm interested in and what I do in my work is kind of connect these meanings around the shade or shades of empire within Fuller's descent to the Down v. Bidwell case and the insular cases to a form of racialized haunting, and thinking about this, the limitations here between inclusion and the desire for inclusion, as well as you know, indigenous rights. So the limits of a civil rights framework within the case study of American Samoa, but also many of the other US territorial cases. So even though you have people like Tuawa and the many other plaintiffs that were part of that case, as well as Fiti Samanu, which is the latest iteration of that case, the American Samoa government, as well as representative in Congress, have spoken out against this case because of its infringement on Samoan sovereignty, on Samoan governance, and also and so forth. And so the framing of this movement, though, is, I think, connected to how we think about TIND, because it sort of bridges both liberal and conservative approaches and rhetorics around multiculturalism and inclusion, as well as patriotism, right? So for many people, their thoughts are, well, if they're within the United States, then they should be granted US citizenship. And this is what everyone desires, right? When in fact, Samoans strategically draw on this very racist ruling, the 1901 insular cases, to create distance and to assert their own sovereignty over their lands, over their own forms of citizenship within the, you know, complicated matrix that is, you know, this, the ambiguity or the liminality of territoryhood. And so that's just a small snapshot of where my work is and how I'm thinking about these connections to TIND and these notions around racial progress and the civil rights rhetoric and the limitations of that. There's more that we could talk about too, in terms of, you know, the racial rhetorics of the case law and that sort of thing. But in the interest of time, I'm not really going to go there. I do want to make two connections before I stop. And one is to Miley Arvin's work, in particular, her book, Possessing Polynesians, of which there's an excellent book review as part of this special issue, in which she's talking about the colonial racial logics of whiteness and the racialization of Pacific Islanders in particular, that I think has a really interesting connection to these conversations around whiteness and Aryanness, and that colonial discourse of Aryanness that has traveled across empires, you know, across British to US, for instance. And then the other connection that I want to make that we can probably pick up in Q&A is the complicated figure and legacy of Tulsi Gabbard, who is the first Hindu representative in Congress, but also Samoan from Hawaii, and part of these really complicated politics. Again, a really interesting case study in how we think about representative politics, and also of that convergence of both conservative and liberal discourses of multiculturalism, both in these cases, but also in larger politics. And I'm thinking here of the amazing intro that Linda and Sonia offered, in terms of, you know, the gestures around Kamala Harris and how we understand her in this moment as well.
Thank you so much. We're going to pass it to Vizue.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Kiri, for your presentation and for all your very thoughtful acknowledgements up top, both of Linta and Soniya, but also a recognition of the moment that we're in, and how we are holding many heavy thoughts and care in our hearts. Again, my name is Mizue. I am an organizer. I am intimidated by scholars, but here I am. For the past 20 years, I've organized at the intersection, as Linta mentioned, at the beginning of the criminal, legal, and immigration systems. But what more than just two decades, what it really was a time where we had experienced an unprecedented growth of what I call the homeland security state, really the evolution of the most world's largest system to identify, track, police, deport, exclude, imprison people at the world. And one which is, you know, the US doesn't hold this as a unique characteristic of its governance regime. It's the US, the European Union, Australia, but increasingly a system of control that's come to define many ways in which countries govern, wealthy countries govern globally. And so my work has been focused on combating hierarchies of belonging, very much at this intersection of criminalization, the criminal, legal, and immigration systems. And this work is very much grounded in the histories that are represented in the collection of articles in this excellent journal. So, and my work is currently focused on how surveillance fuels state violence and corporate power, including the expansion of border regimes deep into the interior of countries, very much on the international boundary lines and globally into other territories. And of course, as the journal notes, and as Kiri mentioned, these are legacies of empire. These are not new systems, even though the technology is new. They very much reinforce existing continuums of control. But so this is who I am, this is what I do. And so I'm going to just talk a little bit about how these things come together for me and how they relate to the topics in the journal. So if we're trying to understand the growth of the homeland security state, I didn't turn on my timer, so I'm going to try to turn on now. You know, it's due in part due to the combination of many factors. One of them are very harsh immigration laws, which really kind of became maximally bad in 1996, I guess, after kind of a decades of increasingly becoming more restrictive. Part of what these laws did is they made domestic policing effectively a pipeline for deportation, so merging the carceral system with the immigration system much more clearly, but automatically through technology. And then, of course, as we can see, increased funding for border policing and severely limiting pathways to legal status. And so, you know, and when we say that severely limiting, it's just important to hold that for people in the United States who don't have authorization, there has not been a way for many millions and millions of people to regularize that status for over 35 years. So then what happens when you combine this legal infrastructure with a political will that's racist, xenophobic, and very, virulent, mean, with funding, right? So that's what DHS represents to us in 2002. On top of these immigration laws, the U.S. expanded its budget tremendously for migration policing, a 2,000% increase currently since 1990. And with that money and this political will and the legal infrastructure, they were able to deport over 6 million people in about 20 years, which is unprecedented historically. But it's also become a permanent part, a perpetual part of U.S. governance, right? Policing and deportation. And that is that formerly it was episodic. Now it seems like it's a permanent part of their system until we break it down. And then also just in terms of thinking about the money and resources spent on this, in the name of Homeland Security, the U.S. spends about like $25 billion a year to police migrants. That's more than the military spending of many countries, including Canada, Turkey, and at the time of this statistic, Israel. But also the political momentum, you know, I think it's this idea that the journal highlights in terms of hierarchical belongings based on racial categories, that we can see how now racialized proxies have become the named targets, right? So criminal aliens, illegal border crossers, terrorists. And it just represents the continuum of the ongoing project of nation building that requires the constant articulation of who belongs, who's granted rights, and who doesn't deserve any. You know, just in terms of the global expansion of the U.S. border regime, I like to use this quote that was in the 9/11 commission, which said very blatantly or forcefully, the American homeland is our planet. And I think for many of us who've organized around these issues in the United States, you know, we didn't have the awareness of how much the system has actually grown. Obviously, it's, like I said, everything's a continuum, but exploded after DHS in terms of a U.S. border externalization regime, where to the point where now Mexico has one of the world's largest detention capacities in the world on behalf of the United States, and also deports more people to Central America every year consistently than the United States does, right? And then there's the technology that accompanies this. There's the shared police training, massive collection of biometrics and personal information, police criminal history data sharing globally across borders. And, you know, I think this point around technology and surveillance, I just wanted to talk a little bit more about that as I wrap up my points. So I think people are aware that there's a lot of talk about a global focus on AI, artificial intelligence policy. Both the EU and the United States have created frameworks on how to address these issues. And, you know, one of the things that is a hallmark of kind of the immigration control regime since the beginning of time is this idea, I think, of legibility and visibility, right? People having to register, the Alien Registration Act, or, you know, Chinese immigrants having to have their photo taken, right? To be able to prove that. So all this to think about how the importance of legibility and visibility in terms of regimes of control. You know, when the US occupied Afghanistan after 9/11, identity dominance, I don't know if people have heard this term, but that was part of their idea on how they were going to conquer, right? Is that we have to know who every single person is. The Department of Defense created a massive catalog of civilian. They would go up to civilians on the street, gather irises, fingerprints, and put it into a database, right? And so just to think of this idea of identity dominance as being something that animates every department now of the United States, Department of State, Department of Justice, historically, but also the Department of Homeland Security, that's building, you know, one of the world's most massive collection of databases populated with by the UN, right? The refugees, iris scans, by policing agencies, you know, through every system in which biometrics and information is collected, they're amassing it. And, you know, bringing it back to the topic of the issue, just seeing how easily this the issue of immigration laws are weaponized then in this case at this convergence of kind of surveillance technology, legibility, and all that stuff. So on the issue of denaturalization, under Trump, we saw that they had an operation to basically try to, you know, scan every single natural person who was naturalized to identify people that they could deport, right? So this was discovered through a Freedom of Information Act request by advocates. And they found out that the U.S. CIS was using software to scan the records of millions of immigrants to try to flag people powered by Amazon Web Services. You know, it initially flagged, I think, 120,000 cases of people that they tried to deport as potential threats to national security and public safety. And, you know, just to think about just the weaponization of these laws and what these laws were intended to do, I just think it's a cautionary tale, right? Under Trump, the extreme politicization of of the immigration system built on the extreme politicization of it under Obama, right? Where it became the, you know, people with criminal convictions were the target, and then Bush before him, where, you know, people, Muslims were the target, all of this coming together under Trump. And with the threat of reviewing, you know, continually reviewing it and denaturalizing people. You know, this is the context in which we ended our organizing under the Trump administration into Biden. And, you know, the ideas that animate the system and the laws that exist to enforce it maximally still persist. And I just wanted to end on the point of why borders, right? Borders serve to maintain an unequal world order. You know, the biggest predictor of who builds the walls and who, where the walls are, is the wealth gap between the country building them and the people that they're trying to keep out. And as we know, global inequality continues to grow, but the solution continues to be to police more the borders more and more heavily at the cost of thousands of lives a year. And so, you know, just as laws conceal the violence of empire, conceal it and reproduce it, I just wanted to end on this point that technologies do the same. You know, I refer to the AI regulations that the US and the EU are considering, and both of them carve out from protections of these laws migrants, people on the move without authorization, as not being worthy of being protected under these AI regulations. And, you know, I think just as we have to overturn, you know, we just have to think about the role of ending these pernicious technologies as we overturn the ideas and practices that reinforces the hierarchies and fuel the powers invested in maintaining them. Thank you.
Mizue, we can turn to Prachi.
Thank you so much. That was really wonderful. Again, thank you, Linta and Soniya, for having this conversation, and great to be in this conversation with you, Kiri and Mizu. Nice to see some folks on the Zoom call here. I think I'm going to, I was thinking about whether how much to focus on kind of the historical context and how much to focus on the current one. I think I'm going to start with focusing mostly on the historical context, and then maybe in the Q&A we can talk a little bit about the current context of caste and Hinduism and Hindutva and Hindu nationalism, India, what is India, what they're telling it, what India is to us now. All of those contexts are really matter today. You know, Thind case really provided, you know, talking about this question of Aryan, what is the Aryan race? What is the high caste Hindu? Who's of Indian blood? All these questions, you know, and then we're talking about and thinking about that case today, you know, highlighting what Soniya and Linta did in the opening about what is the, you know, racial progress of those people from that time to today is a question of like, who's the racial progress for? And that, you know, that's a question that looms large today too. And then to understand all these realities of, that are inherent in the argument that Thind, was making on his behalf, there is a lot of beliefs and questions that are still, that come to us today, right? What is Hinduism itself? How has it always existed as a religion? Are upper caste Hindus Aryans? Where did that even come from? What is caste and how is it connected to Hinduism? Was it a colonial creation? And then what is Indian, and does it equal Hindus or Hinduism? These are the questions that are, that were questions in the early 1900s when Thind was making the case. And these are questions at the heart of what our struggles are today in the early 2000s, almost 100 years later. And caste was not always a social reality, right? It came to existence thousands of years ago in the middle of like the first millennium BC, and it was created by something called Brahmanism. So it was created by Brahmanism, which is spiritual philosophy. So it from the beginning had religious sanction. And Dr. Ambedkar, who is the famous Dalit leader and the draft of the Indian constitution, he called caste a graded hierarchy with a descending scale of contempt. in which people are assigned by birth to a group that is typically has a specific job. And so he said it was a graded division of laborers, and labor and caste and labor and class, these are intrinsically connected from the beginning, and the beginning of the creation of what caste is. And caste is always pervaded by notion of purity and pollution. So whoever is the highest caste is most pure because they're doing a certain kind of intellectual, certain kind of labor that is supposed to be divine, defined by birth to be pure. And the most lowest caste, or even the people who are outcasts, which Dalits are supposed to create and do labor that is polluting, and therefore they are untouchables, right? So this was ordained by religion, and central to the functioning was controlling it through women's sexuality, because it was controlling it through marriages, controlling it through endogamy. So these things are the controlling of sexuality and controlling it through mental and manual labor has been always crucial to what caste has become and caste continues to be. And caste always breeds separation and it breeds superiority, right? The survival of the caste system is maintained through that hierarchy and maintained through superiority. So every caste, almost all castes, have somebody below them. And for each caste to maintain their superiority, they have to say caste has to exist, because then how are they going to oppress the caste below them, except for Dalits who can't? So this is the way that the system of caste has maintained itself. In terms of Hinduism and what that is, you'll notice I haven't really talked about what Hinduism is, because Brahmanism is what really became dominated as Hinduism. It never really existed as a religion. And the word was not used to designate a religion in India until the colonial rule. So there you go. That's where colonization comes in. Not that colonial people did not create, the British did not create the caste system, but they did participate in creating what we know as Hinduism today. And Hindu really derives from the river Indus. People in India used to call it Sindh, people in South Asia, the subcontinent. And then some people who are other side of that river couldn't pronounce the S, so they started calling it Hindu, and that area became Hindu, Hindu area. And so anybody who living in that area was called Hindus, including Muslims. And then colonialism brought some challenges, and the British came into that time and they said, oh, we want to impose some taxes on these people. What are we going to do? We need to create some laws. So they created laws based on the so-called local customs. And the local customs, who did they get those from? They work with the Brahmins. They work with the Brahmins to create the local custom based on Brahmin, the idea of Brahmin advisors who told them that these are the texts. This is the Manusmriti, which is the text, another text. And they said, this is our local laws, which are really casteist. And this is the laws that you should abide by. And so they created two systems of law, Muslim law and the Hindu law. And who are Hindus? Everybody else that is Hindus, that is all from different caste system. And you just have to, British had to agree to that, right? Because it was promoted as we are all in Hindus equally within this. There's no such thing as discrimination. This is our law. And this is what's still something that is Hindu nationalists are still promoting. When they're opposing the caste system, they're saying, by asking for caste protections, you're saying it's Hindu-phobic, because you are saying that there's caste discrimination, which doesn't exist. We just live in different kinds of groups equally, and this is a multicultural framework, rather than saying that there's this caste discrimination that exists. And this ideology comes from the time before colonialism. During colonialism, it was entrenched by British, and it exists till today. And this is, the Hindu nationalists are continuing to maintain it and maintain this kind of ideology. So where did Aryans come from? What's the Aryan connection here? The Brahmin elite and the Hindu nationalist elite at the time promoted, early times, promoted this many theories in India, referring to people coming from India, coming to India from the outside. So the Aryans came to India, and the Aryans was Aryans were the Hindu, the highest caste Brahmin elite, right? So these are the people that came, and they created this golden age of civilization and brought that civilization to India. And this Brahmin and dominant caste elite stopped using this interpretation of Aryans and in the 1930s, around the same time, or a little bit after Thind was arguing his case. And the reason that they stopped using this is because there was a strong non-Aryan, non-Brahmin movement of Dalit and the oppressed caste communities at the time that was opposing and saying, okay, if you're saying you're Aryans and you're coming from the outside, then we're the indigenous people. So you should leave because we're the indigenous people and we're non-Aryans, we're Dravidians, and this is actually our land. And so that's the time when that movement started gaining power and, you know, popularity among the people, among the Bahujan, which is the all caste that's not Brahmin caste. It gained popularity among those people. The Brahmins stopped using that term. And it's been also, the Aryan conquest theory has also been proved as not necessarily standing ground on many levels and by historians. But in some ways, parts of that theory continued. There were, popular favorites like Vivekananda, who was the Hindu nationalist favorite, used this term. He brought it to even United States and California and Chicago. When he spoke, he talked about the Aryan future that was grounded in kind of, you know, that Aryans being the Brahmin descendants and that we are this kind of racial superior people that is connected to all the racial superior people across the world. And so that theory, that notion, that ideology of superiority of among the Brahmin community and the upper caste community has been there since thousands of years through the colonialism till now, and that remains. The reason that the Aryan and non-Aryan movement is important to think about and study is because, like I said, the non-Aryan movement, which was led by people like Jyotiba Phule, who was a pioneer in this struggle. He came from the flowering caste, the caste of flower, you know, creating the gardener caste. He was a pioneer in the 1800s, and he promoted this, if the Brahmins created the mythology of being Aryans, then he promoted the, counter mythology of what I talked about is that we are the non-Aryans, we're the Dravidians, and that he popularized that tradition. He wrote a book called Gulamgiri, which is slavery, this is a book in which he turned the theory upside down. And even in that book, the first book, part of that book is dedicated to the good people of the United States who are fighting slavery. So he was already making those connections to people struggling against racism and racial domination in the United States. So even that struggle and the connection to that struggle goes back to that time period, and that struggle continues today. And so he fully really put forward this united vision of the liberation of what he called the Stri, Shudra, and Atishudras, which is women, lower caste, and Dalits. So bringing them all together, saying that these are all communities that are oppressed by what is now being called Brahminical patriarchy, the dominance of Brahmins, which is connected to and very much intrinsic to patriarchy, which is not, cannot be disconnected from that. These people need to unite together and oppose it. And that is the movement, that is a non-Brahmin Dalit movement that continues to exist as part of both the Indian and South Asian communities and the culture, and that has been brought to United States through the struggle on caste annihilation today. So today, as Dalit Americans across the country and anti-caste people who are joining the Dalit Americans across the country, to fight for caste protection for oppressed castes within city policies and state policies, the biggest people who are opposing them are not white people. The biggest people that are opposing them are Hindu nationalists who are saying that by putting these laws into place, you are creating Hindu phobia and you're promoting Hindu phobia. And so this is a term that is promoted because Hindu phobia is not really a structural reality, right? There's anti-Semitism is a structural reality. Anti-Black racism is a structural reality. Islamophobia is a structural reality. Anti-Hindu bigotry exists in the form of xenophobia and anti-immigrant sentiment, but Hindu phobia or Hindu phobia is not necessarily the structural form that exists in the United States. But Hindu nationalists are using this term to weaponize against anybody who brings up caste discrimination, anybody who brings up Islamophobia, And they're, you're using it to intervene so that they can really shield the Hindu fundamentalist ideologies, the Modi government, from criticism, and really wield it as a reactionary weapon against progressive measures that are being proposed by these movements. And so this is kind of the going back to kind of, you know, from when we come from the time of the Thind, when somebody's arguing to be white and be adjacent to whiteness by saying that we're actually not we're not actually dominant caste, and being Hindu upper caste means whiteness, is no different than how from what white Hindu nationalists are saying, because they are very much in line with the similar ideology of white supremacy today. So there's so many things to talk about, but those are the kind of points that I've been wanting to make. And then we can talk a little bit maybe in the question and answer about how we can oppose this and how it connects to more of some of the questions that are coming up for people about what Hindu nationalist movement is doing and what the movement to oppose Hindu nationalism and white nationalism in the United States can do and should be doing here.
Thanks, Prachi. Thanks to all of our speakers, actually, for very rich and, in different ways, building on topics from the issue and then also from the case, which we can go into more if people have questions about that. Oh, sorry. We wanted to give some time for the speakers, if you have questions or comments to each other, because in our minds, like the work the work that each of you do, we're like, yes, it's connected. That's why we asked you to speak. But we wanted to offer you that opportunity also, if you have connections or comments or anything of that sort. We set aside some time.
I had a question for Prachi, and I just kind of wanted to hear you continue to talk about to continue your discussion on Hindu nationalism and Hindu phobia and what that movement looks like now, in the US. So, and thank you so much for that really incredible and rich history of the terms. It's so important.
Thank you for that question. I feel like I went very fast. I was trying to stay within the 10 minutes. I think speaking of what is happening in the world today, and as we're facing kind of more McCarthyism, when we're raising our voices against different things that are happening in Palestine, of course, genocide happening there, any criticism is kind of turned into a conversation about anti-Semitism, right? So this is the question that I'm thinking about also when I'm thinking about when Hindu phobia is weaponized and that gets popularized as a term, what will happen in the future as people who are in power in India are calling for genocide of Muslims. They're calling for genocide of Muslims in India while they are promoting the idea of the whole country that equates in itself as a Hindu nation. And that ideology holds sway in among the Hindu nationalists who are promoting a similar kind of the same ideology in the United States, right? And so when Hindu phobia is weaponized, Hindu phobia is put forward and that gains momentum, when Dalit Americans and anti-caste people and Muslim Americans of Indian descent are creating messages to oppose this, Hindu phobia can be popularized as a term and it can be very dangerous for people who are opposing this. And this is something that we really, really need to think about. So that's just one thing in terms of like thinking about the current moment and, as we kind of support the people who are resisting that now and thinking about the current issue now, but also thinking about how it connects to all of our work today. So that's one thing I was thinking about too, but it's a big, the Hindu nationalist movement is like the oldest, they are the oldest fascist organization that still currently exists, right? right? Like it was created 100 years ago or something. And that organization, the Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangha, which was that organization that was created, it still exists today. They still have members today. And they have counterparts in the United States through Vishwa Hindu Parishad of America. And that Vishwa Hindu Parishad of America has a pact called Hindu Pact that is a 501(c)(4) that is still promoting to make sure they're reaching out to the people on the Hill to ensure that their ideologies gain traction and that there's no opposition to whatever they're doing in the future. So that is a huge thing that is happening and that needs to be stopped.
I have a question for either of you or both of you, and it's not a well-formed question. It's just something I think about. You know, when we think about the function of immigration policing, bordering, and its ties, of course, to racial capitalism and obviously othering hierarchies as being essential for capitalism. I'm just curious in terms of your reflection of in this current moment of how you are looking at these questions of hierarchy and nationalism or racialization as being related to neoliberalism or whatever economic order.
Yeah, I mean, I think I'm also just thinking about some of what you were saying, Mizu, also around the laws that are created to oppress communities by governments and how those are popularized also in different parts of the world, right? You're talking about Mexico, which is adjacent and is supporting the U.S. Immigration system and that repression, but also there are similar laws that are created in countries like Myanmar, in India too, that are opposing certain, that are leaving out certain ethnic religious minorities, right? So Myanmar has done that with the Rohingya community, and that's also connected to genocide. And then India also used similar kind of laws and has promoted and created laws. Whether implementing it or not is a challenge, but they have created laws that are similar to what U.S. has promoted in terms of saying that a certain kind of religions are citizens of India, and certain people are not allowed if they're not citizens of India. So Muslims, anybody else who is not Muslim can become automatic citizens coming from the border adjacent to the country. And so just thinking about how in these times, repressive laws are copied by governments across the world, and also how that connects to and promoting that and allowing that to happen is also part of kind of the geopolitical understanding of like who's allowed, which countries are allowed to kind of go forward with those kind of laws, right? India right now is a big importance to the United States. So whatever they do, whatever the Indian government does, whatever the prime minister does and promotes, even though there is human rights violation and grave concerns that even the U.S. watchdogs and U.S. and like government religious centers have said that the U.S. government won't say anything or do anything publicly about it because there are geopolitical concerns. So those are all part of the both geopolitical order and the economic order of the times that we live in today.
Thanks, Prachi, for those incredible comments, and then also Mizue for your talk and also for this question. I think I'm thinking about this question around capitalism and hierarchy and neoliberal order in two parts. One part within the Pacific is to think about the Pacific securitization of the region, and to think about, this is where the U.S. military, this is one of the most militarized areas for U.S. empire, right? And so we're often thinking about borders between the Canada border sometimes, but also the U.S.-Mexico border. But the other big borders is the ocean, the Pacific, right? And I think about that a lot in the work that I do, in particular because of, Samoa is not many people are aware, unless you've, you know, looked at Samoa on a map, but or been around other Samoans, but the U.S. border runs right through the islands. So you have independent Samoa, and then you have the territory of American Samoa. And so we think a lot about borders because people have to go back and forth, or people do go back and forth. And it used to be a lot easier prior to 9/11 for people to move back and forth between the islands. And now, and as a subsequent, you know, impact of, you know, as you have so eloquently elucidated and mapped for us, like the increase of the border regime and control and technologies, it's become very much harder for people to move back and forth. And I'm thinking about this too in terms of, you know, the Trans-Pacific Trade Agreement, which didn't really go through, but it's still kind of working in this kind of shadow formation around, you know, major countries and capital in Asia and Australia and New Zealand, and their partnerships, the US, United States, and the ways in which, in terms of refugee movements as well as deportations, the Pacific Islands also often becomes like a sort of container for people, that liminal space for people to move, for Australians, also for into the US, you know, that sort of kind of configuration of security, and that zone, which and how we conceptualize that. And so I'm thinking about the impacts of militarism, as well as the impacts of these huge major flows of capital, and how they rework movements and power within the, you know, Pacific region, you know, and as I said earlier, as how it's been remapped no longer as the Pacific Command, the oldest military command in the United States, but as the Indo-Pacific Command, right? And what they're envisioning is the future for military buildup, not just across the Pacific, but into Asia, and as that launching point to the Middle East and to other parts of the world, right? And that heavy buildup in sites like Okinawa, Guam, and then also the sort of grip that it has in particular in Hawaii as well. And then I'm also thinking about the flip side. And this is where I think I'm thinking about this in terms of, you know, the couple of citizenship cases that I've been thinking through, and that is the ways in which we're contending within the Pacific community about our complicitness within militarism, right? So the high rates of enlistment, and these high rates of enlistment, military enlistment, go hand in hand with training in policing and movements towards policing, and in particular, the deployment of soldiers who were once deployed to Kuwait and Afghanistan in the, you know, early 2000s, post 9/11 moment, during the Iraq War, were then redeployed along the U.S.-Mexico border, and then also their partnerships with the IDF, right? And so, you know, you have all of these sort of complicated ways in which we also have to deal with our complicitness because of these constrained opportunities that were created by, you know, colonialism. So like constrained opportunities for, you know, for other types of work, where the largest recruitment station in the US is in the Pacific. There it's in Samoa, and it's also in Guam. So there's this, those are the ways that we think about it in terms of like both, there's a structural sense of constraint, but then there's also the ways that we're having to kind of think about our relationships to other people around the world. And, you know, another example of this is how Pacific people have been also thinking about the recent vote within the United Nations and the resolution on Gaza, and how many Pacific nations voted against the ceasefire. And so there's that also, these major conversations happening in the Pacific, both in terms of these long histories of alliance with Palestinian people and other oppressed people around the world, but also of the way that our the constraints of capital as well as of colonialism within this kind of these multiple and overlapping empires in the region. So I had a question for you, Mizue, as well, and that was to think about this I was wondering, because you had talked about, you know, the ways in which empire is concealed often through law and also through technology. And I was wondering in your work, how that, you talked a lot about biometrics and what, identity dominance. And I was wondering how does this work in terms of how do you all reimagine the geography of U.S. Border Patrol and also U.S. Empire, I guess, through your work around surveillance? And so in particular, I'm wondering here, like, you know, given that the military's, you were making these gestures to the global. And so I guess I just wanted to hear more about that. It's mainly that.
That's a great question, but I want to make sure I understand it correctly. Not reimagine like in an kind of an abolitionist sense, but how is it actually happening? Yes. You know, I was thinking as you were talking about the military bases and kind of U.S. empire and surveillance, like how the Philippines often also, like prior right to DHS founding, like that's where the surveillance and policing techniques were evolved and tested. But I think, you know, clearly to this point always of how we are seeing kind of this historical continuum, right? Whether it's even pre-colonial times, as you know, Prachi brought up, but it's like, how do we grapple with these very entrenched systems of control? And so to your question, what one of my current projects is called the Everywhere Border. It's a collaboration with a group in Mexico called R3D and ILIT at Temple University. And what we're trying to do is map out what we call these digital infrastructures of control, but digital infrastructures which are laden with political agendas, right? So if you're looking at, say, for example, Latin America and the Caribbean and the U.S. history of intervention there, you have every single department that's involved there, right? The Department of Defense, obviously, in the military bases, the Department of State around the drug war, and then also with the DOJ, and then you have DHS, and then every single thing that is used as a way like, oh, well, the U.S. is concerned about drug trafficking, right? Let's change the institutions then in Mexico and other countries so then they can prosecute along the lines of how we would like to shape those regimes. And then let's also foster a climate that's positive for corporations at the same time that we're implementing our systems of policing. And all this to say that I'm trying to make a very condensed point around how what I think is accelerating at this moment with the advent of the securitization regime and kind of digital technologies is a merger of all these different agendas that like a flip can almost be switched at any single time, right? So you can have like, you know, people detained at military bases in Guatemala, say, right, when they wanted to hold a whole lot of people, and we'll tie our U.S. funding, you know, to that. You're going to get U.S. funding if you police your borders for us, and then if you increase your police force in this way. And, you know, I think the legacies of a lot of these different initiatives around policing of problems that the U.S. has fostered, right, the drug war, the gang war, it's all happening at a rapid pace with, I feel like maybe, this might be slight overstatement, but I'm just going to say it anyway, a convergence of agendas, right? Under this like paradigm of, or regime of securitization, where more policing and more punishment becomes the solution to everything. And so I think it's scary times, right? I think what's happening right now in Gaza and kind of this idea of like, you have all the powers that are invested in surveillance states now feeling like, well, we now have legitimacy to like ramp it up in this context of AI policies that are being dictated by the handful of very, very wealthy companies. They're richer than a lot of nations, these companies, right? Dictating then what are the regulations of these going to be when their money is made by extracting as much information to sell to police, to sell to different corporations, to use for themselves, to create new products. It's a real challenge, I think, the convergence of, you know, in this very particular way, the surveillance industrial complex, and, you know, how just the money flows, research institutions funding then, you know, DHS initiatives and police training. So I wasn't a very articulate point, but I think it's exactly the thing that, you know, you're naming is we, and, you know, as people organizing to change these things, we have to understand these so much better, right? I mean, all the, like, thank you so much, Linta and Soniya, for bringing us together, because I feel very animated in terms of thinking through kind of the synergy and the connectivity of these kind of different approaches to looking at the histories into this current moment. But, you know, authoritarianism in its many forms, democracy masquerading at authoritarianism masquerading as democracy, straight up authoritarianism, right? That has like basically a stronghold because it has a geopolitical importance to the United States. And I think really a way in which the solutions are getting more and more narrowly defined where, and the narratives are getting more and more controlled. This is the thing that is just bubbling up for me a lot. So I'll just end my rambling there, but thank you for that question. And for your work.
So there is one question in the chat, and I think that is for Prachi. Do you think you can speak more about the Muslim genocide going on in India?
What to say about this in a few words, but I think it's such a long history of it. And I think we have to really think about it in the context of the fact that the current prime minister of India presided over a pogrom in the early 2000s. When he was chief minister of a state in India. It has been what, 20 years since that time. And just a few years after, he became the prime minister. And since he became the prime minister, and even as he was, you know, in campaigning for becoming a prime minister, even before that, you know, people in the U.S. had actually mobilized to make sure that, when he did visit or was trying to visit the United States, that he would be banned, that his visa was banned he was banned from coming into the United States because of what happened in Gujarat in the early 2000s. And so this person who was banned from coming to the United States just spoke in June 2023 gave a speech at the joint session of Congress, invited by one of the most progressive House representatives in the U.S. and so and Indian House representatives in the U.S. So it is a topsy-turvy world that we're living in, right? Even we're talking about Gaza and what's happening there, because somebody who presided over a pogrom came to power. There has been emboldening of not just the people in government and different levels of government who are speaking and giving calls to genocide of Muslims openly. So not just people who are the chief ministers and other ministers who are saying that, but there are other people who are godmen, quote-unquote Hindu godmen and others alike, who are openly giving calls and openly saying, when Modi spoke for us when he's the chief minister, this was the right thing to do, and it's because of that we're able to say and we're able to do what we're able to do right now. And so this is openly being said. And then when Trump visited India, a month after he visited India, there was a pogrom in Delhi at the time. And so what's happening in India and the genocidal violence, the calls to genocide, the laws that are being proposed that, you know, criminalize, you know, people who are opposing the government law, and then people who are being political prisoners who are in jail, not just Muslim political prisoners, not just people who opposed things like the Citizenship Amendment Act, which is excluding Muslims from coming in into the country. There's people who also oppose caste discrimination who are in jail. So the situation in India is of authoritarianism, is genocidal, it's fascist, and it is all consuming in a way that is really hard to oppose, right? And the media itself is being completely, if you imagine Fox News in it's hard to really tell right now what other MSNBC and other places too, in terms of what's the difference. But in general, Fox News is supposed to be the conservative right wing media place, but all of Indian media is like Fox News. The way that they talk, the way that they support the government, way that they promote genocidal conversations and talks, media is completely dominated by that. So just the young people and the society, it's very hard to tell, you know, what is actually, you know, what we're actually able to do to actually oppose this, even while there are many people who are opposing this and are getting arrested. So there's a lot more to say, but that's what I'll kind of just say in terms of there are genocidal calls and there's pogroms happening. Genocide has not happened yet, but it could happen.
I think we're going to close out. And I think that, you know, just thinking about what Prachi was saying and what Kira Mizue had said before, one of the, you know, like something that Sonia and I would talk a lot about when we're putting the issue together and before was just about like, what are the complications and complicities around kind of like, you know, like demands for inclusion in a nation state with its limitations and what it opens up. And that is one of the things that we thought the Tind case and other such cases really ask us as scholars and just people to question. And so thank you again to our speakers. And yes, so if you look in the chat, there is another reminder that the issue is available online and right now it's open access. So a lot of the topics that came up are addressed in different ways in the issue itself. So thanks everyone for joining us and have a great week.